Welcome, everyone, to this edition of Vladimir Savchuk podcast. And I believe that the topic that will be discussed today not only will be relevant to what is happening in our culture, in our world, but also if you're a Bible-believing Christian, this will also help you to understand some of the end times theology and perception and prepare you actually to do something about it right now. Joel Richardson, I have had him already on my YouTube channel, and he has shared a very insightful teaching about Islamic Antichrist. And if you have not seen that broadcast or listened to that one, there's a link below. Make sure you go and check it out. He was born in the United States in 1971, a Christian author, teacher, filmmaker. He grew up in a Christian family, studied theology in Kansas. And after college, he moved to the Middle East and then lived actually in Egypt, Israel, and Turkey, where he studied Quran and Islamic beliefs. He has many books that he wrote, some very powerful, insightful things. And he actually just returned from Middle East just about a day ago or so. And he's joining us today, and he's going to share about what is happening in that part of the world. So, Joel, welcome.
Thank you very much for having me on, Pastor Vlad.
And how are you doing? Did you recover from a jet lag?
Yeah, I slept good last night. I finally got home about midnight last night and got to bed probably around 1, got up at 5. So I think I'll probably fully recover tonight.
Wow. Could you give us a brief summary for those who may not be aware of the historical conflict between Israel and its neighboring nations? And what are the main reasons for the contention and the war that we are seeing today?
Okay, that's a big, big question. I'll try to keep it real simple. So, you know, in the latter part of the 19th century, late 1800s, you had the rise of the Zionist movement. So for those of your listeners that are not familiar, of course, it was in the first and second century that Israel, you know, okay, so we're talking 40 years after Jesus, you have the Romans essentially overthrow a Jewish rebellion, and then that rebellion sort of unfolded over the next 70 years. You had a messianic movement in Israel where they believed that this individual, they called him Bar Kokhba, was the Messiah. And this resulted in literally, for all intents and purposes, every last Jewish man, woman, and child being expelled from Israel. So you had a roughly 2,000-year dispersion. Well, again, it was in, as I said, the late 1800s, that a, and I need to qualify this, a secular Jewish movement arose for the purpose of returning to the ancient promised land or the ancient homeland of Israel, you know, called Palestine at the time. It was just under Ottoman control. And so over the next 50 years or so, you know, leading up to 1948, you had many Jews returning all over the world, but primarily from Europe, to reestablish and replant their ancient homeland. It's a fascinating story. But of course, during that time, you had a remnant of inhabitants, mostly Arab, Christian, and Muslim inhabitants of the land. As you can imagine, there were a series of conflicts that unfolded, which ultimately culminated with, at the time, roughly 700,000 Arabs fleeing their homeland. They were actually called upon by the different Arabs to flee. And then in the process, you had about 700,000 Jews who were expelled from the various surrounding Arab nations. So you had this massive sort of population transfer. So we lived to see the establishment of a Jewish state. Let me just say this in terms of the historical conflict. So from that time, the glue, the ideological glue that really held much of the Middle East, the Arab Middle East together, was what was called Arab nationalism. And very simply put, it would be, it doesn't matter if you're Shia Muslim or Sunni Muslim, if you're a Christian, or if you're a Druze, all of these things, it really doesn't matter. Your prosperity is my prosperity. Rising tide floats all boats, this type of thing. But in order to hold them all together, you need a mutual enemy. And the Jews, Israel has sort of always been the mutual, we all agree that we don't like the Jews, you know. Of course, people are people. I don't want to paint with too broad of a brush. You know, there's good people and bad people no matter where you go. But it was sort of this mutual hatred of Israel that you, in many ways united much of the Arab world. That began to change after the Arab Spring, where a lot of these nations started essentially being taken over by much more radical Islamic elements, the Muslim Brotherhood. These ideologies started spreading. We saw, of course, the overthrow of Mubarak, you know, who was this longstanding dictator in Egypt. We saw the overthrow of multiple leaders and the rise of groups usually connected to the Muslim Brotherhood. And so the past 10, 12 years has just seen a complete shift in the Middle East. And we've seen a real rise in sectarian division and bloodshed and so forth. And so what we've seen here in just the past few days with this attack of Hamas in the south, Hamas is essentially a branch of the Muslim Brotherhood. This is a movement that rose up out of Egypt. It's rejected by, I'm going to say, the majority of Arabs throughout the Middle East today, including Muslims. Most average Muslims, they cannot stand Hamas, but they've done a very good job at winning over many by sort of exploiting this hatred of the Jewish people. And unfortunately, in the West right now, we're even seeing many who are not Muslims, just, you know, secular Westerners who are buying the propaganda and getting behind Hamas. So this is a violent, as we've seen, terrorist organization. I mean, this is ISIS. And so that was kind of a strange broad overview of this conflict, but that sort of brings us up to where we are today.
Yeah, and I've been seeing a lot of people actually posting support for Hamas and pretty much viewing Israel as the oppressor, and pretty much by supporting what is happening, what Hamas is doing to Israel is pretty much, you know, it's legal and it's morally justifiable because it's Palestinians are resisting the oppressor, when in reality, you know, that's not how it is. For Christians, what is Israel, what role does Israel play for Christians, and what Israel, why does Israel matter for believers in Messiah?
So there's so many reasons, Vlad, why Israel matters. You know, Paul the Apostle takes some time in Romans chapter 11 to try to drill it into the minds of Christians, particularly Gentiles. He tries to drive it into our minds to recognize where we've come from, what we essentially owe the Jewish people, and their role in this unfolding plan of redemption, God's story of redemption. And so in that, he talks about the fact that there was a divinely orchestrated prophetic hardening of the majority of Israel. You know, so he says, you Gentiles, you guys are going to be so arrogant. You're going to look down on Israel. You're going to say, well, they rejected Messiah. You know, we accepted Messiah. Look at us. And Paul goes, quite right, you know, you've been saved by grace, but don't forget the fact that the Lord purposefully hardened many of them in order that you Gentiles, who formerly you were far off, you were wild, you know, like wild olive branches, you weren't part of that program that he had been cultivating. You were not recipients of the covenant promises that God made to his people, but nevertheless, you've been brought in. And Paul said, you've been brought in because he hardened them. He hardened his own people in order that you, you know, sort of these former pagans, for all intents and purposes, could be brought in. And he says, now listen, this is not a permanent situation. This hardening that the Lord has allowed to happen to Israel, it's temporary and it's partial. So, of course, not all Jews rejected Jesus. Mm-hmm. Not all Jews rejected their Messiah. Mm-hmm. There's always been a remnant. He says, but the time will come when that hardening will lift. Mm-hmm. And when that happens, when the full number of Gentiles comes in, then Paul said, then the blindness will be lifted. That hardening that the Lord has placed on them will be lifted. And then all Israel will be saved. And so when the story is all said and done, you have Jesus, who is the King of Israel, the King of the Jews. He's the Messiah. He is the Son of David. He will return from heaven in blazing fire to punish his enemies and to reestablish the throne of David. Okay, so to reestablish, I apologize, the sun comes in this window this time of the afternoon. But he will actually reestablish the royal Davidic monarchy. Mm-hmm. Okay, so when that happens, okay, the kingdom of God, that's another word for the kingdom of God, is the royal Jewish Davidic monarchy. And Jesus, as the Jewish Messiah, will rule the nations. He will rule the whole world from Jerusalem. So we need to understand this program, this project that we're part of, and not to listen to Paul the Apostle and not to be arrogant.
And so Paul tells us not to be arrogant, but to respect of what God is doing right now amongst the Gentiles, knowing that this hardening of the Israel, like you were saying, is temporary and it's partial. You know, Joel, I'm kind of thinking about every author in the Bible being Jewish, you know, sure. Jesus being born in Israel, you know, God taking this whole nation to bring man Jesus, the Son of God, for the whole world, and then Jesus coming back, you know, not in New York, not in Los Angeles, not in Toronto, but to Israel and establishing, like what you were mentioning, being the Son of David. Could you speak a little bit more into that kingdom of God? What does the kingdom of God mean? Because most of us think it's just Christianity. It's us being Christians, going to heaven, and God kind of, some people think, just completely forgot about Israel, and everything is about the Christians now.
Yeah, exactly. You're right. No, in fact, I would say most Christians read the Bible through a very Gentile, Christian-centric lens. But yeah, as you said, the reality is the Bible is, and it always has been, a thoroughly Israel-centric book. And so I'll point out a portion of scripture that it's very interesting. At the beginning of the book of Acts, Jesus actually appears to many of his disciples, and it says for a period of 40 days. Now think about this, Pastor Vlad. For 40 days, the resurrected, immortal Jesus appeared to them, and he gave them a personal Bible study. It says, concerning the things about the kingdom of God. And then in verse 6, these disciples that had just listened to Jesus give them a personal Bible study about the kingdom of God for 40 days, the question they asked him is, they said, is it at this time that you are going to restore the kingdom of Israel? Now, the disciples asked a lot of dumb questions, and Jesus most often rebuked them, or the author of the gospel would say, like, what they just asked was really dumb. But there's no correction. Jesus doesn't say, no, I'm not going to restore the kingdom of Israel. He says, it's not for you to know the time. He says, you go make disciples, you wait for the Holy Spirit to come and go make disciples. You know, it's up for the Father to determine the times. But the reality is, their question, their expectation that Jesus would restore the kingdom of Israel, it was a thoroughly biblical and right expectation. And that's an expectation the vast majority of Christians today do not have. So we need to understand that when we say the kingdom of God and the kingdom of Israel, they are one in the same. When Jesus comes back, he will restore the throne of David from Jerusalem, as you said, not from Independence, Missouri, as some of the Mormons might think, or Salt Lake City, you know, not from Damascus. A lot of the Muslims think Jesus will return to Damascus. No, he's coming back to Jerusalem to reestablish the throne of his father, David. Again, to restore the royal Jewish Davidic monarchy. And that's a very foreign language to most Christians. But to the apostles, this would have been entirely understandable. And it's essential that as Christians, we get back to that understanding, to understand the Israel centricity of the story that we are part of.
And not to embrace the replacement theology. And why are you against the replacement theology? Because quite a few people have embraced that pretty much God has threw away Israel, he's put us instead, but the Bible doesn't teach that.
You know, replacement theology, this is a term that a lot of those who embrace it, they get very upset when you use this terminology. They say, no, we don't believe in replacement theology, we believe in inclusion theology or fulfillment theology. Well, this is just, you know, putting lipstick on a pig. You know, you're trying to dress up something that is, it's disgusting, quite frankly. You know, I like to actually use a term that is more accurate. It's divorce theology.
Oh, wow.
Because at Sinai, God himself entered into a betrothal covenant with Israel. And what many Christians who believe in replacement theology are essentially saying is that God is, he's like that sort of middle-aged man that just got tired of his old bride. And he, you know, divorced her and he moved on to his new bride. He got himself a new younger model. Now, you know, of course, we see this among people all the time. And this is sort of the quintessential, you know, we look down on people like that. We say, you know, you went through a midlife crisis and you left your wife, the wife that you covenanted with God until death do us part. And you moved on to, you know, a different individual. God is not like that. See, how we represent God is very important. It's very important to him. It's very important for our witness. God is faithful. Mm-hmm. And so the bottom line is, and that's really what this boils down to, is are we proclaiming a God who is faithful to his promises? Or are we proclaiming God as, you know, again, that sort of insecure middle-aged man that goes through a midlife crisis and moves on to a new bride? No, God is faithful. And so the very notion that replacement theology is biblical, it is an affront. It's disgusting. It's divorce theology. We owe God a more faithful witness concerning who he is.
Wow. What's happening with Israel right now, does any of that relate to the biblical end-time prophecy?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Now look, when Jesus gave his sermon on the end times, we call it the Olivet Discourse, Matthew 24, Luke 21, Mark 13. These are just three different versions of the same sermon. It was on the Mount of Olives. That's why we call it the Olivet Discourse. This was Jesus's one of the most profound warnings in anything that he said throughout the Gospels. And in that, he says that at that time, in the last days, there will be a tribulation such as has never been since there was a nation until that time. And he's essentially harking back to that which the prophets, many of the prophets spoke of. We could talk about Joel or Zechariah, and they talk about the nations, the Gentiles, under the leadership of the evil one, of the Antichrist, who will unify and gather together in the last days against Jerusalem, for the purpose of essentially of killing the Jewish people. I mean, again, when Jesus says it will be a time of tribulation such as has never been, we see this in the book of Revelation, where Satan, the dragon, the serpent of old, is enraged and he goes after the woman. The woman is Israel. And it says the Lord will protect the woman to some degree in the last days. And then Satan goes after who? The Christians, those who follow the commandments of Jesus. They have the testimony of Jesus. Mm-hmm. You know, so in the last days, Satan will go after who? His people, Israel, and those of us who are Christians, who are essentially, it calls us children of the woman, children of mm-hmm. Israel. You know, we're not Jews, we're not Israel, but we are framed as children of Israel. And so to go back to the replacement theology issue, you know, we have many of our Christian brothers and sisters who say God's done with Israel. He's no longer, they're not any longer part of his plan. I said, well, if that's the case, then why is Satan so determined to destroy them? And where does this demonic hatred come from? You know, if you have any discernment, you say, where is the primary focus and rage of Satan in the earth right now? Why are all the nations throughout the earth in such a state of hatred toward Israel? Why does the United Nations issue more statements, more joint declarations of condemnation against Israel than every other nation in the earth combined? Why Israel? It's because Satan is enraged. Satan knows Scripture. He knows where it's all going. He knows that Jesus is coming back to Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. And so he's doing everything he can to thwart the plan of God. And as Christians, we need to have discernment and to recognize that something very sacred and holy is happening there. And listen, Paul in Romans 11, he refers to Israel. He says, regarding the gospel, you know, they don't believe, the vast majority don't believe Jesus is the Messiah. He says, they're enemies for the sake of the gospel. As it relates to the gospel, they're enemies. He says, but because of God's promises to them, because of where it's all going, he says, they're beloved. So in that sense, they are our beloved enemies. And we as Christians are called to be humble and to stand with them in solidarity in an hour like right now, where the unimaginable has happened. In January of 2020, the ministry that I am currently sitting as the chairman of the board of, Frontier Alliance International, we brought about 80 Christians to Israel. We took them down to the border, the kibbutz, one of the kibbutzim that is right on the border of Gaza. We were given a tour of the kibbutz. You know, they talked about how so many of their children have PTSD because of rockets hitting their kindergarten and this type of thing. And then we get the report, and it was a very impacting experience for a lot of Christians to see the security issue that Jews are living with today, trying to raise their children. And this is the kibbutz, Pastor Vlad, that just had over 100 people murdered in cold blood, slaughtered children in their cribs. And so, you know, people right now on social media, you know, they're like, well, Israel, they're enemies of the cross. They don't support Christianity. Or, you know, they point to videos of some Orthodox Jews spitting at Christians on the ground or this type of thing. Look, we're called to love our enemies. And yes, they're not all supporters of the gospel. But there are times where it's not about choosing teams. Oh, well, I'm a Christian, you're a Jew, you're a Muslim. This is an issue of being human. This is an issue of being human versus being animals. And so this is a time that is so essential that the Jewish people feel the support of the Christian community. And unfortunately, many in the Christian community are partnering ideologically with their posts on social media. They are partnering with Satan. And wow. This is a critical moment right now that we do stand with Israel and let them know that they're supported, they're seen, they're loved. And I could go on. It's been a very emotional week.
I can only imagine. That is so heartbreaking. From the Christian perspective, when it comes to the end times, the role that Israel plays, and I mean, pretty much all of the end times theology, all of the end times teaching is all around centered, not around Rome, not around Europe, but it's all around Israel. All the attacks will be on Israel. And you have a very insightful teaching in plenty of your books about how the Christians, how the Bible describes Christians' Antichrist is pretty much matches the Islamic Messiah. So looking at the Islam faith, and you've studied the Quran, you've studied their theologians and their scholars. What does this mean for them? What is the Islamic end times view of this situation? Are they coming closer to their Messiah?
So, you know, obviously we've talked about this in the past. I've written a lot about this. And, you know, in a moment like what we're experiencing right now, I want to be very careful because, and I want to add a qualifier to something I've already said. There are many very good Muslims. There are many very good Palestinians. There's Christian Palestinians right now. And we need to this is not about just, you know, again, when I say it's not about choosing sides or, you know, picking teams. Of course, right now, Israel absolutely has every right to defend themselves, but it's important to qualify and recognize, and Israel, by the way, does very much recognize, that there are many very innocent Palestinian men, women, and children who are caught in the middle of this nightmare. And many Muslims today, they don't live by their own end-time prophecies, call them nominal Muslims. But there is a segment of radicals, of apocalyptic, you know, Muslims who are driven by their own prophecies. And yes, they're expecting, they call him Imam al-Mahdi. This is their sort of prophesied Messiah figure. And they also believe, by the way, that Jesus will return to assist the Mahdi, their primary Messiah figure. But they believe that this Jesus will be a Muslim. In fact, that Jesus will return, think about this, to tell all the Christians of the world, you guys had it wrong. You're following a false religion. I never claimed to be God. I never claimed to be I never died on the cross. I never claimed to be divine. Rather, I was a Muslim, and you Christians need to accept the true religion, which is Islam, and you need to submit to Imam al-Mahdi. And so this is actually what many of these radicals believe. And yes, they believe that many of these prophecies are coming together, and there's power in prophecy. There's power in false prophecies. And so much of what we're seeing, this hatred, this bloodshed, is being driven by these things. And I'm going to quote this one prophecy because it is driving many of these radicals. It's called the prophecy of the Garkard tree. So it says that before the day of judgment, it says that the Muslims will fight against the Jews and kill them until there are only a few Jews left hiding behind a tree or a rock. And then even the tree and the rock will cry out and say, "Oh, faithful Muslim, there is a Jew behind me. Come and kill him." So you actually have within their prophecies this belief that they will participate in a slaughter of Jews, and that this is what God wants. Now, what does it say in John 16, verse 2? Jesus said, "In fact, the day is coming when those who kill you will believe that they are serving God. They do these things because they don't know the Father. They don't know me. They deny the Father. They deny the Son," which is exactly the theology, the spirit of the Antichrist. John 2, 1 John 2, 22. This is the spirit of Antichrist. He denies the Father. He denies the Son. Why are the nations in a rage? Psalm 2. They align themselves against the Lord and his Messiah. The Lord says, "Here's my answer. I'm going to place my anointed one, my Messiah, on the throne in Zion, there in Zion." So absolutely, there is prophetic implications to what we're seeing unfold right now. And unfortunately, let me just say this, many Muslims have been set up. They have been deceived by their own prophecies. And so our job as Christians is to pray for them and say, "Lord, open their eyes. Open their eyes to see this deception that they've been programmed to look for, essentially look for the Antichrist as if he is their long-awaited Messiah figure, that you would open their eyes in the same way that he opened your eyes and my eyes, and that many, many Muslims would come to know him, and they would come to worship the Prince of Peace."
Amen. Do you believe there could be a lasting peace between Israel and its neighboring countries?
Well, there will be. There will be a lasting peace after Jesus returns. There will be a lot of temporary peace between now and then, and then there will be, deceptive peace. Mm. But there's a principle here that I want to say that's very important. You get a lot of Christians, they read the Bible and they say, "Well, the peace that's coming is not real peace." And they have this real cynical attitude. As intercessors, we are called to essentially imitate Moses. You know, the Lord said to Moses, he goes, "Moses, get out of my way. I'm going to kill all of them. I'm going to start over." And Moses actually stood between Israel and God, and he said, "God, no, but for your name's sake, because of your reputation, don't do this." Now, you ask most evangelicals today, if God says something, you go, "God said it, boom, get out of the way. Obey God." Moses actually, and this is a very deep spiritual principle for intercessors, it was Moses interceded and appealed to God not to do what he said he was going to do. And what I mean by this is, yes, there's going to be a lot of false peace in the future, but nevertheless, we as Christians should fight for peace. We should be peacemakers. I was just in Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is working to establish a peace agreement with Israel. Of course, all that's happening right now is that Iran got involved. They saw the potential of what the Saudis were trying to do, and they said, "No, we need to stir up this insanity and this hatred and this bloodshed to thwart this peace." As Christians, we should support efforts at peace, even if we don't believe it's going to last forever. Peace is a good thing. And if prophecy, if our view of prophecy causes us to fight against something that's good, such as peace or friendship, then we're approaching and relating to prophecy wrong. And so there's a deep spiritual principle here that we need to get a hold of. We need to contend for things that are good. And maybe it'll go sideways. Maybe it'll go wrong in the future, but it's still a good thing. But ultimately, the lasting peace will only come when the Prince of Peace returns.
Amen. Amen. And Joel, what are some projects that you are working on? I saw on your social media you're also raising funds for some of the charities that you are doing. Are you supporting any efforts over there in Israel right now? Or what are some of the projects that you're working on right now?
So as I mentioned, I presently am the chairman of the board of a ministry called Frontier Alliance International. And so we've been raising money, simply to take care of supplies and so forth. I mean, just look, if you want to stand with Israel right now, you stand with the IDF. You stand with the people that are protecting their men, women, and children from being slaughtered. That's how you show solidarity. That's how you show friendship, and that's what we're doing. We've also launched a project called the Genesis Project, which is essentially we're calling Christians from all over the world to come to Israel. And rather than just visiting historical biblical sites, which is what the vast majority of Christians do, we come over and we will connect with the IDF and local Israeli municipalities to get trained to do crisis response training. And so a lot of people don't know this, but Israel is actually one of the forefront, I mean, the leaders in the world. You know, if there's an earthquake in Nepal, Israelis show up. The buildings collapsed in Florida, Israelis show up, because they're very proficient at crisis management, this type of thing. So what we're doing in this is we're preparing to be able to assist Israel, you know, to have the training necessary if we want to assist them. But not only that, let's say there's some humanitarian crisis in El Salvador next month, that Christians from all over the world show up to take care of those in crisis wearing shirts that has Hebrew and English. This is a project. This is a friendship project. We are Christians that are in partnership with Israel, and we are creating a global good neighborhood, if you will, goodwill. And we are ambassadors and representatives, not only of Jesus, but of Israel. And so this is the Genesis Project. We're launching the first pilot program by the grace of God if, you know, things settle down in Israel this December. If not, we'll have to delay a bit. But yeah, these are a few of the projects that we're working on. Again, it's Frontier Alliance International.
Frontier Alliance International. And guys, we're going to put the links below where you can contribute. Our ministry will also contribute to this so that we can help people that are right now on the front lines and just really help to alleviate from whatever we can. But I think the lesson that Joel presented today is that we have to be supporters of peace. We have to pray for Israel. We have to stand for Israel. And we have to stop hiding behind biblical prophecies as an excuse to always make fun of peace, knowing that, you know, this peace might not last. I mean, even the peace we experience in our own life, a lot of times the ultimate peace we'll experience in heaven, but it doesn't mean that we shouldn't value it, support it, or seek it. And so, and I think it's a good reminder for all of us to participate in that, as well as to pray for our Palestinian friends, both Christians and not Christians, Muslim people, so that they will come to know Jesus as their Messiah. Joel, any final words you have for us?
No, it's just, you know, I'll say, you know, as we all know, these are incredibly sober times. This past year, I've been preaching a lot. You and I talked last time about the issue of the rapture. Mm-hmm. This is a little foretaste. We're seeing just a dress rehearsal, if you will, and it's been horrible. But what's coming is going to be far worse. We are going to see, I mean, Jesus warned. He said, at that time, many will fall away from the faith. The storms that are coming are far greater than most of us are prepared for. And it's essential that we get on our knees, that we humble ourselves, and that we embrace humility and the fear of the Lord in this hour. And that's a word for myself and for everyone that's listening. The fear of the Lord and humility will guard us and protect us for the storms that are coming. But it's time to prepare our hearts and lay our hearts before Him now, before the storm is upon us. I mean, it's really here. It's here, it's now, and so now is the time to prepare.
Amen. Amen. Guys, thank you so much. Links are below if you want to donate directly to the ministry that Joel is involved in. Do it today. Thank you, and share this video with somebody.